I'd like to introduce our next keynote. It's my great pleasure to introduce Sarah Mustafavi, who is an associate professor in the Paul Allen School of Computer Science and Engineering at University of Washington, before UW. She recently moved to UW. Before that, she was assistant professor in the Department of Statistics and Medical Genetics at UBC in Canada, and a faculty member at the Vector Institute. Sarah is a recipient of several awards. She was a recipient of the Canadian Institute for Advanced Research, CIFAR AI Chair in 2018, and Canada Research Chair in Computational Biology. She obtained a PhD in CS from the University of Toronto in 2011, and she performed a postdoctoral work at Stanford with Daphne Koller. Sarah does absolutely fantastic work, and her research develops applied machine learning methods, statistical methods for understanding the relationship between genome, biological function, and disease. And I'm super excited today to hear her talk on machine learning methods for extracting meaningful patterns in large genomic data sets. Thanks, Sarah, for your time.
Okay. Great. So thank you so much for the invitation to speak here. It's really an honor to tell you about some of our recent work. I think the title might be self-explanatory, so let's just jump right into it. So I want to start with a simplified story. As scientists, we all love simplifications. So what if we had this simple linear path that would connect a locus in the genome to expression of a particular gene to its protein level to disease? Well, if biology were this simple, we would all be done solving many diseases. And instead of using these fake Zoom background, which one of them I'm using now, we might be self-isolating in much nicer tropical places. But alas, we're all here and still far from solving even simple diseases where we know a handful of genes are involved. And the reason being that biology is way more complex, and very simplified models and very simplified assumptions are not good enough. So let's talk about this complexity. First of all, we have more layers to gene regulation. We have this epigenome layer and metabolome layer, and we're probably going to discover new layers as we can measure biology better. Then within each layer, we have different kinds of parts that form latent modules or functional groups. We have broader interactions within each of these layers of gene regulation. And then we have feedback across layers that create buffering and redundancy. And then on top of that, we have environmental factors like loosely defined, for instance, the tissue context or the cell context or exposures that modify all these different interactions. So because the picture is a lot more complex, we are very far from understanding how to really connect genotype to phenotype. And really the problem of computational biology, as I see it, is to be able to solve this inference problem where we approximately understand the list of parts that we need to think about, to go from this list of parts to some sort of dynamic interaction directed picture, so that we can figure out for a particular outcome or a particular disease where to intervene in the system to get the effective results that we want. And now the challenge is that we know very little about which of these interactions exist in which context. And this is a very huge combinatorial search space. So while we're facing this challenge, there's two good things going for us that can help us in this endeavor. First of all, we have lots of new technologies, and new technologies are being invented every day for measuring different layers of biology, connecting genome to phenotype. And nowadays, we even have technologies that allow us to measure pairs of these layers together. And as these technologies are maturing, we can apply them to large number of cell types, large number of samples to collect really big data sets. And second, we've had major advances in machine learning methods that now allow us to take raw measurements and construct hidden representations and semantics from those raw measurements that are really allow us to make really accurate predictions. So kind of a toy, the really common example of this is in object recognition, where machine learning methods have really allowed us to solve many of the challenges in object recognition by allowing us to abstract away from thinking about pixels, which are the measurement units, but to hidden components, for instance, ear, nose, and tails that are present that can allow us to make accurate predictions. Now, while we have these two really key ingredients, large data sets and really nice methods to allow us to abstract away from data that we collect to make accurate prediction, there are these are not enough. And we need to address challenges, at least on the machine learning side, to be able to apply them in a meaningful way. So two very critical open challenges are, I'm going to talk about vignettes from these two. One is that while we can fit very complex models, how do we robustly interpret these models to figure out what are the concepts and hidden representations that we learn and use that to learn something about biology? And the second is, while machine learning models can really extract and exploit pattern in data, they don't distinguish on their own between patterns that are useful, potentially causal, versus patterns that stem from artifact and confounding factors. So how do we make models that can favor one kind of pattern to others? And so in these two directions, for each of them, I'm going to tell you a vignette from our work. First one, and I'm going to tell you about it in the context of understanding immune differentiation, and the second in the context of understanding gene expression mechanisms underlying Alzheimer's disease. Okay, so let's jump right into the first one. So the motivation to first problem is very familiar to regulatory genomics audience like you, and that is that we want to figure out how is it that every cell and cell type in an individual's body essentially has the same copy of the genome, yet we have many different cell types with many different functions. So this is a cartoon from immune system showing a small subset of cell types that we know of among possibly 100. And we know that based on 30 years of immunology work, we know that these cell types have distinct functions, but yet they're all getting their instructions from the same genome. Well, part of the answer is also very familiar to your regulatory genomics audience, is that, that answer itself, to at least first approximation, lies in the genetic code itself, in the genome. And that's because we know that basically cell type differentiation goes back to differential usage of regulatory regions by different cell types. So here I have a cartoon of two different cell types, NK cells and CD4 cells, two immune cell types. They're using different regulatory regions to control downstream gene expression, and this is how they implement specificity. And the idea is that these differential regions by design have differences in sequence composition that allow for different combination of transcription factor binding events. Now, while we know at a high level how this process works, we don't have enough detail to answer what and why questions. So what question would be, given a regulatory region, which cell type is it active in? And the why question would be to go one step deeper and ask, given a regulatory region, which we know is active in a particular cell type, why so? So what information is embedded in the sequence itself that allows the cell to make certain determination about activation pattern of that regulatory region? Now, in the last 5 years, we're getting very close to answering this what question, and that's because there's tons of different epigenomic profiling assays that are being applied in large consortium setting to annotate the genome to regulatory regions in different cell types, tissue types, and contexts. So I have some example of the technologies on the bottom and some of the consortiums that are systematically applying these across a large number of conditions. So now what I want to talk about is how do we take data like this that allows us to annotate genome in a dynamic way to go deeper and answer this why question. How can we use this data to interpret the sequence information itself to learn about cell type specificity? And I'm going to talk about this in the context of immune system. So let's talk about the data set first, and then we'll go back to the models. So I got interested in this problem working with the ImGen consortium. So let me tell you a little bit about that. So ImGen is a consortium of about 20 immunologists that applied kind of the latest technology very systematically to a large number of immune cell types. So in the latest data generation effort that was led by Christophe Benoit and Jason Bonarestro and myself from the computational side, what we did was, what Immunologist Lab did was isolate 90 different immune cell types from adult mice. So this is the cute mice mouse over here. So these 90 different cell types that we can relate to each other, through immune differentiation hierarchy, essentially encompass all known immune cell types. So it's kind of a semi-complete coverage of the cell types that we know of in the immune system. And then for each of these cell types, they generated an ATAC-seq experiment profiled in triplicates that I'm going to talk about in this part of the talk. The other thing I wanted to mention is that these cell types are very granular. So I've color-coded, so each node here is a cell type. I've color-coded by the broader lineage assignment, but you can see that within a lineage, for instance, B cells, we have 10 or so different subtypes that immunologists think they are functionally, to some extent, distinct. Now, one way to think about this data is as follows. Basically, at the end of this giant experiment, what we have is annotation track for each cell type, where we can look at the different regulatory regions that are present in that cell type, and some sort of quantitative signal that tell us that, for instance, can correlate with the normalized proportion of reads from the ATAC-seq experiment. So altogether, this resulted in about 500,000 ATAC-seq peaks that sometimes we refer to as open chromatin regions or OCRs. And for each of these regions, we have an idea of how active that is across these 90 different immune cell types. So that gives us a really rich data set to actually start asking interesting computational question. So to go back to this why question, one way, intuitive way to frame this problem is that from the lens of supervised machine learning. So we can say what we would like to do is to train a machine learning model that takes as input these sequences that underlie ATAC-seq peaks that we've identified. They're typically about 200 base pair long. And on the basis of sequence alone, we want to be able to predict activity profile of that sequence. So this is the ATAC signal across the different cell types that have been measured. So I want to make two points here. First of all, I've written here a nonlinear and high capacity model. You might say, why do you want to use a complicated model here? I'll come back to that in a second. But the second point that I want to make is as follows. So our ultimate goal here is not just to make prediction. We care about prediction as far as we care about generalizable models. But in a sense, we're not interested in finding new regulatory regions. We are assuming that we have kind of complete representation of all regulatory regions across a mouse immune system, at least. But what we're interested in is having a model that really learns the relationship between sequence content, sequence alone, and cell type activation in these regulatory regions. And if we have a model that can really predict this relationship, we want to figure out what did the model learn, what concepts and hidden kind of features were learned by the model that allow it to make accurate predictions. So now going back to why do we want to use complex model that makes the interpretation difficult, I'm going to keep it very brief and cite three of my really favorite papers the last 5 years that have, I think, very conclusively shown that for all sorts of prediction problem in regulatory genomics, where we're starting from DNA sequence or some regulatory regions and we want to infer some sort of function, complex model, deep neural networks are blowing away all the other previous simpler models. So there's something about, there's some complexity in terms of the relationship between sequence features and function that complex model and nonlinear model capture a lot better. So building on this previous work, kind of we had two goals and two questions. First of all, can we train models that allow us to really make good prediction at cell type resolution? And I'll tell you why this is hard in a second. And second, we want to really figure out how to robustly discover mechanisms by interpreting parameters of complex models. So not just predicting how things are going to happen, but really, can we figure out some biology based on what the models have learned? Now, why is the problem to think about, why is this problem hard when we think about cell type resolution? Very simply, we have this, what I call a class imbalance problem. And essentially what that is that when we're looking at closely related cell types, they're going to share a majority of their regulatory regions, and it's only the minority, a small subset of regulatory regions that are going to be distinct between them. So this creates it hard to learn cell type specific signal. So as an example, as a concrete example of that, I have this scatter plot on the right here. What I'm showing you is each dot is basically a regulatory region that was we found with the ATAC-seq assay. You can look at the ATAC-seq signal in Tregs, which is the cell type here, here, and TCOM, which is the cell type here. So these are cells that are closely related to each other according to this hierarchy. And then you can see that most of the dots are on the diagonal, meaning that majority of the signal is shared. So now if you want to learn something about specificity of Tregs compared to TCOM, we have to really figure out how to make the model focus on this part of the image and not the sequences that are shared. So, for this problem, what we did was develop a model we call AI-TAC, and this was in collaboration with Christophe Benoit, and who is an immunology at Harvard, and Ricardo from his lab, and two students from my lab, Sasha Mislova and Mark Ma. So we created this model we call AI-TAC, which essentially is a multi-task convolutional neural network that takes as input regulatory sequences, so these are sequences of about 200 base pair long, and predicts at output simultaneously the activity profile from ATAC across all the measured cell type. So there is two aspects of this model that's important. Let's talk about that. First is that it's a multitask model, and by the virtue of being multitask, we can look at all the data all at once, and all the data means almost 500,000 regulatory regions. So this is giving us a lot of data to learn some cool thing from. So by the virtue of being multitask, we have this shared layer, which essentially you can think of as neurons in this shared layers are learning the union of all features that are important for predicting, making prediction across the different cell type on the basis of sequence features. And then the last layer is kind of these task-specific layer, cell-type-specific layer, that figures out which combinations of features are important for predicting any given cell type. Now, the second thing that's kind of important about this model is how do we make it focus on predicting regions that are cell-type-specific as opposed to regions that are ubiquitously active and those are easier to predict. So the way we do this is by kind of manipulating the loss function. And in particular, what we found was that using what we call correlation loss really helps this problem. So what I mean by correlation loss, it's very simple. So we're just measuring the Pearson correlation between the ground truth and the prediction of the model for any given sequence during training. And why this works is that basically it allows us to decouple signal strength from the variance of that signal. And I'll come back to a picture of this later. So let's talk about how the results actually work, how well does the model actually work. So as a first pass, we can evaluate the model on using standard cross-validation. So for this, what we can do is leave out 10% of the data, train the model on 90%, and look at test results. So this is what is showing you here. We're measuring the output of the model by correlation between predicted and observed across these 90 different cell types. Then you can see that this is the histogram of how well we do under real data. We always need the null. So for the null here, what we can do is actually shuffle sequences. So if we destroy the structure and sequences, how well does the model perform? And as unexpected, we see that with shuffle sequences, which is our null distribution, we have a mean of zero versus on real data, it's actually pretty shifted. And in fact, about 60% of regulatory regions we can predict with statistical significance at FDR 5%. So for some of these, we're making actually very good prediction, which this was, I got really excited about this when I started looking at, you know, the individual predictions that we're making. So this is an example. So for one particular test sequence, this top pink bars are what the ground truth looks like. So these are the ATAC activity across these 90 cell types, which we can group by lineage. Then this is the model's prediction. So what you can see is the The activity provides very granular, like even within T cells, subtypes on subset of T cells has high activity, but not others, and the model is capturing that well. So the other thing that I want to mention is what I said about, you know, correlation loss and how it's helping to focus on cell type specific signal. So one way to visualize this is to look at models' performance on individual test examples. So higher correlation is better. And the size of the dot here is the variance of that sequence in terms of attack signal across all the 90 different cell types. So the bigger dots means these are sequences that have high variance in attack activity and regulatory activity. So compared to a more traditional loss, for instance, MSC loss, what you can see is that correlation loss is able to capture, better predict highly variable regions. Now, cross-validation is nice, but the ultimate test of model's performance is when you apply it out of sample on some data set that model's never seen before, hopefully with slightly different characteristics, so we can make sure that we're not overfitting. And why we care about this is that because at the end of the day, we want to interpret the model. So if it didn't learn some generalizable features, there's no point in interpreting what it learned. So let's see how we do this. So here we got lucky in that we found there was another large attack-seq experiment done in human cells, actually in 23 human cells back in 2016 by Courses et al., and using very similar protocol. So from this data, we gathered about 400,000 open chromatin regions, or these are basically attack-seq peaks that were similar in length to the data we had from our mouse experiment. And just to test as an ultimate test of generalizability of the model, what we did was apply our attack model directly on this data without any training or fine-tuning or anything like that, just to see a model trained on mouse, how well does it do on human data? And this was really exciting to me to see that, okay, so these are real human sequences that the model is, that this is the prediction performance in the orange here. And then the shuffled sequences, or we can do something similar. We shuffle the sequences and see how well the model does. And again, we see that for a good portion of human sequences, we're actually making statistically significant predictions. And this is really encouraging because this is actually a pretty hard problem. So if you go take, for instance, mouse regulatory regions and human regulatory regions and try to align them with standard alignment tools, something like Liftover, only about 10% of mouse and human regulatory regions align. So we're getting much more than 10% that we can actually predict with statistical significance. So this was really encouraging, meaning that the model has learned something about the logic of relationship between sequence and regulatory activity that's translatable between human and mouse. Just as a very minor point that I also wanted to make is that this seems to be the limit of performance on human data, maybe because it's a little bit noisy, because we can compare the performance of, you know, a mouse trained model with a human trained model, and that's what I'm showing you here on test sequences. And if we do that, we'll see that pretty much the predictions are correlated, and maybe the human trained model is a little bit better on human data, but not by a huge amount. So now that we have this model, we're pretty convinced that it's making accurate prediction and has learned some generalizable features. Next, what we want to do is figure out what did it actually learn. And this is where all the challenges begin to some extent. So there's many different models you can use for interpreting what complex neural networks have learned. What I'm going to talk about here for the purpose of time is just a simple ablation strategy, but in a particular way. So in particular, we have this three-step approach motivated by previous work, where what we do is first look at the first layer nodes. These are sometimes called filters. And we can figure out what are the short sequence patterns that each of these nodes is recognizing. By design, we know that these should be about 19 base pair long, because that's the length of the filter that we're using in these first layer nodes. So we can figure out which subsequences activate each of these nodes to come up with a pattern that represents what they've learned. The second thing we can do is We can knock out each of these nodes to say how important each node was for making prediction. So when we knock out this node, how much loss do we have, and for which cell type across all the different test OC regulatory regions. And the third thing that turned out to be really important is that we repeat this process across 10 different models. Ideally, you would do it across many different models that have been trained on sampling from the same training data. And the reason why this is important is because these models obviously are non-convex, and what they learn, the parameters, depend on initialization. So by varying initialization and then assessing, do we come up with the same features, we have a way to quantify how robust are the features that we're finding. So using these three steps, we basically came up for one motif for each of this first layer nodes that the model is learning. Then for that motif, we can say how important that motif is to the model. And third, we can say how replicable that motif is across different runs of the same model on the same on subset of the training data. And if we perform this experiment, we get a picture that looks kind of like this. So here, each dot here is represents one node or one filter in the first layer that I was showing you. We can associate that dot with the motif that was learned. We can look at the information content on the x-axis. On the y-axis, we can look at the influence of that motif from the model's perspective. So if we were to remove it, how much error we would incur. And then we can color these dots by our reproducibility quantity. So if we were to train 10 different models, how often would we find the same motif? And if you do this experiment, we see that about maybe just one third of these 300 filters that were just the default number of filters in our first layer actually reproduce across multiple runs of the same model. And this is interesting because it tells us to be cautious about how we interpret these motifs that were learned. So one question that you might have is that, well, if you only 99 of them reproduce, maybe you actually need a model with a smaller number of filter. That's not the case, and I'll tell you why. So if you do this experiment where you can fit different models with different number of filters, filter again is the same thing as the number of nodes in the first layer, and you look at test set performance, basically there's no model with 99 filters that does as well as our current model, which has these 300 filters. Those 99 filters that are reproducible are a subset of these 300. And what this is telling us is that with neural networks, really need over-parameterization to find a good representation of the data. So now that we have a sense of how to interpret these nodes, let's talk about what do we actually learn. And this is another picture that was really cool to me. So what we can do is now take these 99 filters and the motif associated with each of them. These are the ones that we know reproduce well across different training runs, and look at whether or not the motif that we've discovered by the model corresponds to known regulatory factor motifs. And the way we could do this is by pattern matching these motifs with known databases, for instance, SysVP and JASPAR, which include a huge number of known transcription factor binding motifs. And if we do this, this is really something that was really comforting to me, actually, is that out of these 99, the vast majority are color-coded purple, meaning that we found a match for that motif that the model learned from scratch on its own with a known transcription factor binding motif. And the reason why this is cool is that a priori, we didn't know how much, how many of these motifs are going to be new and how many are going to be known. And this tells us that, we actually have a good sense of, based on experiments that have been done in the last 30 years through ChIP-seq experiments and so on, we have a good sense of all major transcription factors. So it's not that there's, some missing transcription factors and they're that we don't know about, but really everything comes down to a combination of these transcription factors that are known that allow for cell type specificity. So that being said, there are still a few number of motifs that we found that didn't have any correspondence in known databases, and we're kind of looking to see what those are going forward. The last kind of slide that I wanted to end with on this part of the talk is, so how complex is a regulatory code? So I only showed you a result for interpreting first layer filters, but of course, models are learning combinations of filters, combinations of motifs that allow them to make prediction at the end. So one experiment you can do is to look at your sequences and ask, for any given sequence, how many filters or how many nodes were important for making prediction? And that gives you a sense of you know, how many potential regulatory elements or binding sites are needed to make a prediction about site specificity of that sequence. And doing this, you end up with a histogram of something like this. So for majority of regulatory sequences, you need about 3 or 4 motifs to make prediction, but there are some that are a lot more complex than that. And kind of these are figuring out how to robustly extract interactions from neural network, which is a very challenging, I think, endeavor. This is what we're working on now. But let me switch to the second topic, which is the systems biology part of this talk. And that is about how do we extract meaningful mechanisms from gene expression data when we apply gene expression data in large cohort setting. And here, what I'm going to focus on is really the problem of artifacts and confounding factors, and how do we separate those from meaningful structure that's also present in the data. So let's dive right into it. As motivation and background, let me tell you how I got interested in this problem, and in particular in the context of Alzheimer's disease. So this started based on a collaboration with Phil DeJager and David Bennett that gave us an opportunity to look at very unique data set from a very unique cohort study. So what is this cohort study? It's called ROSMAP. And essentially what this is a cohort of about 3,000 people that have been followed since the 90s through yearly checkup for all sorts of cognitive function measurements. People are, when they're enrolled in this study, they're typically healthy and they're followed until their death. And the really nice thing about this cohort is that everybody in the study has consented to donate their brains at the time of death. And from the donated brains, there's all sorts of data that are being continuously generated. So there is a lot of neuropathological data, so occurrences of plaque and plaques of different kinds. And these are important for development of dementia. And in addition to kind of clinical data about severity of dementia and things like that. And then on the omics side, there's all sorts of data that are being generated. In particular, I'm going to talk about gene expression data from bulk tissue DLPFC that's currently available for about 700 people. So the first question you can ask is that, can we use this gene expression data? And this is really like, you know, when we talk about brain, this is one of the largest gene expression data sets that exists for brain, because obviously it's hard to get brain sample. So what can we learn from this? Kind of one obvious way to model this data would be through the lens of supervised machine learning again. So you can say, I have this big gene expression data set. So this is kind of heat map showing the gene expression level of the different genes that I can measure. And I want to be able to predict all sorts of phenotype that I've measured in this study. Well, in this case, if you pose a problem like this, you're most likely just going to find garbage. And there's not much you're going to get out of this kind of framework. The reason being is that gene expression itself is a very confounded measurement, especially when we're talking about a severe disease like aging, dementia. So why is that so? We know that there's lots of factors downstream of disease that impact gene expression measurements. So let me give you 2 examples of this. One is demographical factors like age and sex and ethnicity and things like that. The other kind of factors are hidden confounding factors. So things that we might have a sense of, but we don't really know for sure. So an example being, for instance, in dementia, what happens is that there's a lot of neuronal death that goes along with dementia, downstream of disease. So your neurons start dying. And if you think about bulk tissue measurement from the brain that has a lot of neuronal death, that gene expression profile is going to look very different from somewhat healthy brain that didn't have any neuronal death. So this is an example of like a hidden confounding factor that we're talking about when we're talking about bulk expression data. But there's all sorts of other things that you can imagine. For instance, what kind of medication people take or what kind of other comorbidities that have that we may not know about, which in turn correlate with gene expression measurements, and it's going to confound the relationship between gene expression and the particular disease that we care about. So what's the solution for dealing with this? So historically that's from like maybe 8 years ago when large cohorts started being gene expression from large cohorts started being generated, one common solution was to identify what people refer to as hidden confounding factors and completely remove them from data. And the idea was as follows. It's a simple idea. So if you think about our gene expression measurement, we can think of it as combinations of three matrices, kind of a clean gene expression data that doesn't include the effect of confounding factor, one matrix that includes the effect of known confounding factors, things like sex, age, medication intake, and things like this, and a possible matrix that reflects the effect of hidden confounding factor. So the idea was that if we estimate this hidden confounding factors, we can remove them from the observed gene expression data to get this clean data set to work with. But essentially, as it turns out, for most disease setting, this is a very aggressive assumption, because essentially what we're doing is that assuming that any large-scale pattern in the data is relatable to hidden confounding, and we need to remove it from gene expression. So the solution that we came up with is simple, and I very briefly tell you about this. The idea is that we're going to have this three-step approach. In the first step, we're going to create summarize the large gene expression matrix in terms of modules or clusters of genes that basically capture correlated pattern. This is just to simplify the data. In the second step, we're going to use prior knowledge to assign some sort of meaning to the patterns that we see in the data, and I'll come back to this in the next slide. And in the third step, we're going to learn a conditional dependency network that relate modules of gene expression to each other and to a large number of phenotypes that we could have measured. So this is how pictorially this is going to look like. Essentially, we have these modules of co-expressed genes. We have some prior notion of what are the different factors that can impact co-expression. So I've listed some of them here, for instance, neuronal proportion, alcohol use, or all sorts of other things. And these we just have to roughly know about based on kind of background knowledge of the disease. Then what we're going to do is try to associate modules with this kind of prior meaning, and then learn conditional dependencies between all pairs of modules and all of the phenotypes that we can measure. And if we think about this problem in this way, then we're not throwing away any signal a priori. We're always conditioning on things. So for instance, if you think that proportion of neurons is a confounding factor, where if we include it as a variable in this model and this conditional dependency network, we're conditioning on it when we're looking at, for instance, correlation between another module that doesn't reflect cell type proportion and tau measurements. Now, applying this framework to the actual gene expression data set, what this allowed us to do is to find one module cluster of co-expressed genes that was upstream, that we saw is directly connected to these neuropathological measurements and clinical AD. And we couldn't explain this relationship that we see between this module, which is just has an index name of module 109, with these measurements. And this is not explained by any other module that we have in this network. And we know that this a priori, we can't associate it with any kind of confounding factor. So this allowed us to kind of go one step further and do some experiments working with Tracy Young-Pierre's lab at neurology at Harvard. And what we did was basically dig down in this module of gene expression that we found that where on average genes in this module expression correlate with the neuropathological outcomes that we care about. And we did some simple knockdown experiments to see if we knock out genes in this, some of these genes that we've captured here, does it affect rate of amyloid secretion in model systems? And in particular, this was a cell system of amyloid secretion. And then what we observed is that for two of these genes that ended up being actually very important for insulin signaling, which has an interesting connection to Alzheimer's disease, we see a signal that if we knock out these genes, rate of amyloid secretion actually goes down. So kind of the last point that I wanted to make here was that this was a really interesting case where, you know, we found some set of genes that seem interesting, and in experiment, we can to some extent have a validation showing that they're important for process of amyloid secretion. But if we had to look at the data with the initial way I told you about supervised learning or simple correlation between gene expression and phenotype alone, I will go back to my shared slide, and then let's go here. So there was an interesting case that these genes actually didn't come up at all in a simple analysis. And then just to end, summary of for conclusion, I think I'll just make two high-level conclusions. One is that oftentimes data sets that we analyze, raw correlation in the data and the raw measurements are not what we're looking for. Those are typically confounded, and we need to force models to learn the patterns that we care about. So I gave you two examples of that in this talk. And then ongoing work, we're expanding on both of these directions that I talked about. In one direction, thinking about how to robustly extract interaction patterns from deep neural networks. And in the second direction, how do we extend models like this in multi-omic setting? So with that, I'll just acknowledge all the wonderful collaborators and then ask for any questions. So the first part of the talk was done in collaboration with Howard Benoit, our immunologist colleague at and Ricardo from his lab, and then two really talented students, Sasha and Mark over here. The later part of the talk was done in collaboration with Phil, David Bennett, and Tracy. So thank you so much for the invitation, and I'm happy to take any questions.
That was fantastic, Sarah. Thanks a lot. So I'm going to start with questions from the audience, and there's quite a few coming in. That's great. So the first question is from Christina from Carnegie Mellon. She says, very interesting work. You mentioned working with 200 base pair sequences. Is your CNN model limited to the same length sequences? And how can you generalize to mix sequence lengths in your data sets?
Yeah, that's a fantastic question. So actually, we thought about this a lot because there are several models that actually use much larger input sequences. Going all the way, I mean, there's models from David Kelly that I love going up to like 1 million bases. I think we try to focus on shorter sequences because we really wanted to interpret what the motifs that were learned, like actual motifs, as opposed to broader sequence contexts. And then going to your question of, can you accommodate variable sequences? I mean, you can accommodate it in a very ugly way where you can pad. But there are more fancy ways that you can accommodate it. For instance, if you go to K-mer representation and things like that, and there's papers coming along in those directions that allow you to. So actually, that's something I'm interested in, and we're going to probably look into that in the future. But the question of, you know, how much the sequence length impacts the prediction is very interesting to me. And thanks for asking that question.
Great. Next question is from Julia Zeidlinger. She says, nice talk. Have you tried to apply a trained AI TAC model to predict gene expression data by transfer learning?
Oh, fantastic question. We have not, but we have thought about that. Yeah, so that would be really cool to see how well this could do. I mean, obviously, we're going to do much worse than I think we can predict attack signal because there's more factors that control gene expression. But I think just knowing the limits would be really cool. And we, in fact, have gene expression data from the same cell types. So that would be something kind of somewhat straightforward for us to pursue.
Great. Tasia from Washington University asks, great talk. What percentage of the mouse genome is covered by the regulated regions you studied?
Oh, okay. That's a really good question. So I don't know what, so basically we have about 500,000, so I'll give you the numbers and then you can look it up. So we have about 500,000 regulatory regions. So these are distinct regions, and each of them is about 200 base pair long. So at however long the mouse genome is, then you can figure out, and I'll do this afterwards to see what portion we've covered.
Great. So I'm sure you know this person, Irene Kaplow. she asks, you mentioned that about 2/3 of motifs are not consistent across models. Do you think that these motifs are not biologically relevant, or they are biologically relevant but highly correlated with the presence of other motifs and are therefore not needed by all the models?
Okay, yes, that is an excellent question. I kind of brushed that under the rug. My own intuition is that they're biologically relevant, but on a very smaller set of regions, and probably, as you say, dependent on other motifs, and so it's harder to discover them. But I think proving that is going to be hard. There's things that we can do, but yeah, so that's another kind of thing that I really want to figure out is that how much of this is noise in the neural network and redundancy versus actual biology that's hard to grasp.
That's great. So I'll just end with one really quick question, Sarah. This is really great stuff on both ends. I was going to ask you a general question on what are your thoughts on how you plan to integrate prior knowledge into these both these classes of models for the module networks as well? There's obviously lots of interesting prior data on networks, and similarly for regulatory DNA models, there's also lots of prior knowledge of motifs and so forth. What are your thoughts on that?
Yeah. So I mean, I think it's eventually. I think like as a first pass, I found it very cool to be able to rediscover biology without use of any prior knowledge to the limit that we can right now. But I agree, going forward, now that we know the models can rediscover a lot of biology, they will just be much more powerful if we can actually include biology that's known. So that's going to have a big role in the future. And how do we go about doing that? I think encoding edges in, for instance, deep neural network to mean certain things. And I'm thinking about that in the context of the second part of the work, where we can encode known relationship between genes themselves and genes within pathways and things along that line. But I think there's a lot of new directions to be opened up here. And so that's a really promising area to figure out how to do this correctly.
All right, great. Thank you so much, Sarah. That was really, really great talk. And we'll now move on to the next session.